Sheriff, you can just come back for one quick second.
What's up?
While she's coming, I want you all to know something about this woman. She worked us and worked us. She wasn't afraid to correct us, but the way she corrected us, you have to understand. She said, come on, do it again. I know it's in you, and you're doing so good. And she continued to say that over and over and over until you had to produce or direct a play. You won't understand. But until you get up here and do it, and you see it unfold the way you planned it, but God.
Yeah.
So Shay, woman of God, we thank you so much. And anytime you need to correct us in any way, have your way.
This one goes straight, and as she said, we asked her to write this play, and yeah, a lot of what she did was just out of her heart and passion. She would provide lunch on Sundays after service, and then buying all this props and everything. And so we want you to know how much we appreciate you. So we'll just give you a little token of our appreciation. Thank you so much. Amen. Thank you so much. Let's give that one more time. Amen. God bless you. Father, how we bless you and praise you and thank you for this day that you have granted unto us. And we pray now that as we look into your word, that you would speak a word, Holy Spirit. For we need a word from you. And we pray you have your way. Forgive us for our faults and failures. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Learned a long time ago that if you can't preach your message in 1 minute, you don't know what you're talking about, no how. So this is not going to be a long message, but we want to continue our study through the book of Hebrews chapter 10. And so you're going to have to move rather fast with me so that we can look at this passage and not hold you until dinner time. But in Hebrews chapter 10, as we have walked through this book, we want to look and get our thought from verse 10:36 and a few following verses. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36. Hebrews 10:36. You need to persevere, so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he promised. For in a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous ones will live by faith. And I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. For a few moments on this Resurrection Sunday, the night of the resurrection, we just want to encourage you to hang on in there. Hang on in there. Because the resurrection, all that Christ has done for us, gives us the strength that we need to hang on in there. Songwriter writes, because he lives,
yes,
I can face tomorrow.
Yes.
Because he lives, all fear,
yes,
is gone. And what he's really saying is because of the resurrection,
yes,
because of what Christ not only did for us on the cross, but in raising and being raised the third day, he says that we have the confidence the encouragement, the strength that we need to hang on in there, to keep on keeping on and not give up. We have seen over the last several weeks out of Hebrews, beginning with Hebrews chapter 7, that Jesus Christ offers a better sacrifice. He is a better sacrifice than the sacrifices of the Old Testament. You remember, as we have walked through this book, that we saw in the Old Testament that every year, once a year, the priest had to go into the Holy of Holies to offer a sacrifice for the sins of the people. For the sins of the people every year. But Jesus Christ, being the great high priest, was not like the other priests of the Old Testament. Because when he offered a sacrifice for sin, when he offered the sacrifice for sin himself, it was once and done. Once and done. It, as the text, and as we were reminded this morning, as he says on the cross, it is finished. It is paid in full. So what difference does it make that he has died for us? What difference does it make that he has paid the ultimate price, the ultimate sacrifice? Well, the text says in Hebrews chapter 10, beginning with verse 19, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 19, verse 10, 19, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence, since we have the assurance to enter into the most holy place, that we can have the confidence that we can go to God for ourselves. We can go to God for ourselves. And the text says, if you notice the latter part of verse 19, it is not because we've been so good. We can go to God for ourselves, not because we've been so holy or so righteous. We can go to God for ourselves because of the blood of Jesus Christ. His blood makes the difference. His blood made a way. And we now have a new way opened up to us through the blood of Jesus Christ. And notice what the text says, verse 20. By a new and living way opened us through the curtain. And in Matthew chapter 27, verse 51, it talked about when Jesus died on that Friday, that curtain that separated the Holy of Holies was torn from top to bottom, which lets us know that we all can have a relationship. We all can now have access to God for ourselves. And the good news about that, the reason why it is important that we can have access to God for ourselves now that the curtain has been removed, is I don't need somebody else to go to God on my behalf. I can talk to God for myself. I can talk to Him for myself. He has given me access by this new relationship. And it says, in light of the fact that now that God has given us access to Him, now that God has removed the barriers that separated us from Him, but verse 22 says, now we can draw near to God. Yeah, we can be close to Him. Yeah, we can be in a relationship with Him because of what He accomplished on the cross. Before, I was an enemy of God. Before, I was an enemy of God. But right now, because what He did on that cross, because of what He did and tearing that temple and that curtain, and what He did and accomplishing my salvation, although once before I was an enemy of God, I now can declare, like the songwriter, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God, and God has washed me. God has cleansed me. God has made me whole. And what God has done in providing that salvation is the latter part. And verse 22 says that God has cleansed me from a guilty conscience. Yeah. In the Old Testament, when they made the sacrifices, it was only good for washing the outside. It was only good for cleansing the outside. And although I was cleansed on the outside, I still had to walk away with that guilt. I still had to walk away with that shame. I still had to walk away with that burden. But because of what Christ
has done on our behalf, because of what Christ has done on our behalf. God has removed the guilt and the shame, the burden that once had me bound.
Yes, yes, I once was bound. But because of the blood of Jesus Christ, I no longer have to have that burden on my shoulder. I no longer have to walk around with that guilt. I no longer have to walk with my head hung low. Because of what God has done for us. So you know what he says? In light of what God has done for us, we've got to hold on to what we got. Verse 23, let us hold unwavering to the hope we profess. Let us hold on, because what the devil wants us to do, the devil wants us to give up, the devil wants us to turn back, the devil wants us to be ashamed, the devil wants us to feel like we are not forgiven. But he says, hold on. You gotta hold to your unwavering faith. You can't give up. Because what God has promised, he is faithful. And if God has promised to deliver, if God has promised to bring you through, he won't let you down. There are times I get weary. Times I may feel like giving up. So you know what he says, what we've got to do is he writes to these believers in the book of Hebrews. We've got to learn how to draw our strength from one another. See what he says? Verse 24, let us consider how we might spur one another on to love and good deeds. We've got to encourage one another. We've got to push one another on. We've got to let one another know you can make it. We've got to let one another know, hang on in there. We've got to let one another know, don't turn back. We've got to let one another know, hold on to what you got. I need you. You need me. Can't make it without you. And he said, we got to spur one another on. We got to continue to hang on and we got to lock shoulders. We got to keep on keeping on. Verse 25 says, don't give up coming together. Meeting together, some have gotten weary, some have given it up, but we've got to encourage one another, and the way we encourage one another, we've got to have a time where we get together. You see what he says? Not giving up, verse 25. The meeting together, as some is in the habit of doing, not giving up, coming together. And you know one of the biggest lies the devil make us believe is I can be saved, but I don't need the church. The devil will have you to believe that I can just worship God at home by myself. But I come to let you know, the devil is a lie. Because the text says that we can't give up meeting together. We can't give up encouraging one another. We can't give up spurring one another on. We need each other. We are the body. And when was the last time your arm told your feet, I don't need you? It's connected to the body. When was the last the eye told the ear, I don't need you? Come on, man. It is connected to the body. We need each other. We need each other. Story goes, one time there was an argument. About what was the greatest and the best part of the body. The brain said, I'm the best part of the body. Because without me, the body wouldn't know what to do. The leg says, no. I think I'm the best part of the body. Because without me, the body wouldn't go nowhere. The hand said, no, I'm the best part of the body. Because without me, the body couldn't do anything. The eye says, no, I'm the best part of the body. Because without me, the body couldn't see anything. All of a sudden, the written in spoke up. I would call it what it is, but let me just say. So you know what it did? Since y'all feel like y'all don't need me, I'll just close up. After a few years, after a few days of that going through the re-end, the brain didn't feel like thinking like it used to think. The legs didn't feel like going where it used to go. The hands didn't feel like doing what it used to do. The ears didn't feel like seeing like it used to see. And although you think you don't need it, although you don't think you need it, you may not be nothing but a... But if you're a part of the body, every part is needed. Need each other, encourage one another. But the writer says, let me let you know, as you journey along, there'll be those who you come across who talk a good game. They will be sitting next to you in church. And if you look at them, if you hear them sing in the choir, if you hear them pray, if you hear them serve, you will be under the impression that they are that you think they are. But they are nothing more than a faker and a shaker. Notice they can go through all the motions. Notice, but they know better. They've heard the word. That they've sat in church. They sing in the choir. That they look like they're on their way to heaven. But they are doing nothing more than playing church. It says if we deliver, we keep on sinning. Verse 26. After we receive, there's no more sacrifice for sin. We know better. There's no other way but through him. Notice. Because what they do, if God didn't pray in the Old Testament, when he gave a prophet, now that he has given a greater prophet, how much more serious will judgment be? Verse 29, how much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who trampled the Son of God underfoot? Who treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that was sacrificed talk about they're on their way to heaven, but it's a plaything. But you know what God says to the shakers and the fakers? Who about discouraging instead of encouraging? It is mine to avenge, and I will repay. So he says to these believers, you hang in there. Light of God, all that God has done for you. You got to encourage one another. And the reason why we got to encourage one another is because the devil is working overtime all the time, sending those people out there to discourage us. He sends those out there who are all up in your business. And the reason why they're in your business is not because they are concerned about you. They're trying to tear you down. But what he is saying, and what he wants to encourage us, is that in spite of what we're going through right now, in spite of the circumstances right now, we have got to hang on in that. Verse 32, remember those earlier days? After you received the light, you said, I was going to do better. You know what the devil did? He unleashed every demon in hell on your case. Notice, you endured, you endured, you endured. The verse 32, you endured. Notice, not just in conflict, you endured in grace. Conflict. Yeah. And notice, you didn't just suffer. The text says you were full. Some of y'all can testify. When I was out there in the world, it seemed like the devil didn't bother me. He won't leave me alone. Chaos and confusion all around us. And sometimes the devil is working overtime. We had great conflict and suffered. Sometimes he goes on, verse 33, you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. The devil tried to put you on blast. Other times you stood side by side. You lost stuff down here. Devil tried to take stuff away from you. Yes, yes, the devil confiscated your property. The devil tried to take stuff away from you. But notice what the text says. You hung your head up. You didn't give up. You didn't get weary. Notice, because you knew for yourself that you had a better and a lasting possession. And although the devil took this stuff down here, you knew you had something better on the other side. You know what God says? You hang in there, church. Don't you get weary, church. Don't you throw in the towel, church. Because see, you don't throw away verse 35. Don't throw away your confidence.
Don't throw away your hope. Yes, yes, don't put your religion on the shelf. Yes, I know it gets hard sometimes. I know it gets difficult sometimes. I know it gets trying sometimes. But you gotta hang on there. You gotta press towards the mark. You gotta say the world is behind it. The cross is before me. And no turning back. No turning back. Yes, yes. He said, let me tell you something, church. You need to persevere. You need to hang in there. You need to be determined. No turning back. I ain't gonna turn back. Yes, yes. Because see, you gotta hold on till you get what God has promised you. Yes, yes. And he wants you to remind you of it. Maybe hard right now. Maybe a struggle right now. Maybe difficult right now. You might have sleepless nights right now. You might have tears flowing down your eyes right now. But you know what he says? In a little while. Yeah, I'll be done with the troubles of this world. Yes, because he who will come will show up. When he shows up, he'll make it all right. Yes, when he shows up, he'll make it better. He says, because God is not pleased with those who are shrinking back. God is not pleased with those who are backing up. God don't want, God don't need no coward soldiers. God wants those who are saying, I'm going to run on. See what the end's going to be. Yes, you got to hang in there. When I tell you, you got to hang in there. Doesn't mean sometimes you're not going to have to cry. Oh, it doesn't mean sometimes the devil is not going to be working overtime trying to discourage you. And I tell you, you got to hang on in there. Doesn't mean sometimes. Yeah, you might lose all that you have. Oh, but when you hang on in there, you'll discover that God will show up. God shows up, he'll bring you out. Not only will God bring you out, but God will bring you out all right. Yes, and God said, I'm looking for some folk out there that are determined I'm going to hang on in there. Road may get rough. Going might get tough. The hills might get hard to climb. But I'm going to hang on in there. Jesus,